Navreet really sort of laying out the derivative space for us. I understand that our guest for the show, that's Mayuresh Joshi, is joining us now. Mayuresh, thank you very much. That's fund manager at Angel Broking. We've seen the sort of inertia that seems to have set in the markets. They seem to be looking for a larger trigger. Mayuresh, at this stage, how are you looking at a portfolio?
Afternoon, Fatima. Clearly, I think the markets have given a thumbs up in terms of how the budget has panned out. And looking at the domestic events that are lined up, the election outcome specifically for key states like Uttar Pradesh will hold a key in terms of determining the market trend. But largely, earnings have not disappointed. A lot of analysts had downgraded earnings expectations for a lot of consumer-facing industries, whether that be consumer discretionary, consumer staples, FMCG, autos, auto ancillaries. But largely, I think these companies have beaten estimates, which were moderated, as I mentioned earlier. So again, I think it's going to be a story for the markets in terms of how quickly earnings recovery can be. And again, I think expectations of how quickly credit growth can pick up. It's still languishing in that higher single-digit mark. But if that credit growth figure has to pick up significantly over the next few quarters, and again, with the end-user constraints coming down, you can have a fillip in terms of industrial activity picking up, private capex picking up, which is again expected in the next 2 to 3 quarters. So I think the markets are hopeful that earnings recovery should take place in the first half of FY18, the capex recovery in the second half of FY18. And if the state elections are as per the expectations of the markets, I think we might very well continue the uptrend ahead. But I think consolidation might very well be the key till the results for the state polls probably come out.
You're right in saying, Mayuresh, credit recovery, as far as credit growth is concerned, we need to see a recovery. Also, CapEx needs to grow significantly as well, as far as industry is concerned. All of these are important, crucial factors to determine the course that the markets take from here. But listen, what's happened on inflation on WPI? The number came out not too long ago. We've seen this big spike in the month of January on wholesale price index. It's coming at 5.25%, and compare that to 3.39%. So there is a spike over there. The primary articles, when you consider WPI, the inflation there is coming in at 1.27%, and this compared to 0.27%. So again, over there, we're seeing a spike, primary articles. Manufactured product inflation coming in this time at close to 4%. And here is another pain point, fuel and power, which has gone up quite significantly, over 18% this time. And all commodities index, that is up 1%, while the non-food articles index is up about 2.5%. If you look at another factor, vegetables inflation, that has come down about 32%. Pulses inflation, which was a big pain point, coming in at 6.21%. And basic metals inflation stands at 7.97% this time. Sugar inflation at close to 23%. And core inflation, when you look at that figure, that's 2.7%. So considering how WPI looks right now, you did mention that an interest rate cut is something that the markets would like to see, besides the other political factors as well, the outcome of the elections. Mayuresh, what's your sense of whether or not this will happen going ahead from here? How are the rate sensitives going to behave looking ahead in terms of where the stocks are likely to head from this point onwards?
So again, I think if one really needs to read through the transcript of the RBI policy meet, it is very clear that RBI has stressed upon three important and key issues. A, the spike in crude, as you rightly mentioned. I think the pricing of the crude basket, specifically in the Indian context, has moved higher on a quarter-on-quarter basis, and that does pose upside risks. What happens with policies in the West, specifically in terms of the Trump administration, will have an overwhelming response in terms of how emerging markets behave, both on the debt side, the equity side, and the currency side as well. So there is some amount of upside risk still to be played out on the currency front. And third, I think the core inflation still remains extremely sticky. So in that sense itself, I think the RBI has been very, very cautious in terms of inflation trajectory moving a tad bit higher over the next few months. But again, if one really goes by the transcript and the RBI stands shifting from accommodative to neutral, my entire sense again is that it's going to be a key of how the banks are able to transmit through the system. With 175 bips already cut by RBI over the last few quarters, it is still having some headroom for the banks to cut through on the interest rates going ahead. Now, does that give some amount of impetus for credit growth to move ahead? And as I mentioned earlier, as working constraints have come down significantly, specifically for end-user industries like metals, steel, iron, gems and jewelry, a few real estate sectors, specifically on the MSME side, my own sense is that the traction should very well begin in the first half of FY18. So I think it's going to be a question of how the banks are able to manage their asset liability books and probably transmit the rates that RBI has done. But I think a move on the interest rate, at least in the next policy meet or the policy meet thereafter, looks a little bit unlikely unless you probably have all these three factors clearing out in RBI's trajectory.
Sure, fair enough, Mayuresh. In fact, I'm going to ask you and Vikram to hold on for a minute because we have some developments that are coming in on an exclusive level when it comes to shipping and roads. We understand that the amendments to the Central Road Fund Act are very much on the cards, where the government is expected to provide 5% of the CRF for the development and maintenance of the national waterways. I've got the reporter who's bringing us this story right here with me. That's Chetan Bhutani. He's joining us for more on us. Chetan, just explain to me what this means to shipping in itself and how it sort of changes the current dynamics.
Well, we all know that the finance minister in his budget speech announced about developing multimodal transport and a multimodal logistics hub, which will include good connectivity of states with railways, roads and shipping. So what is on the cards really here is that Gadkari will be using the developing rivers for navigation amongst states for transporting materials, which will literally reduce the traffic and the cost of traveling from one state to the another. So what is on the cards really here is that the Central Road Fund, in which the government gets funding from the budget, has been decided by the finance minister Arun Jaitley. The 5% of that amount, which is for this year, stands at 80,000 crore rupees, which you and we, when we travel and we pay for petrol and diesel, is majorly developed out of the cess that we pay from petrol and diesel. So the 41% of the cess that's paid out on the diesel and the petrol, it will be given to Roads Ministry, and out of that 5%, a pool will be created. So the Central Road Fund, which is literally comprising of the left-wing extremist areas in which the government funds road projects for the areas which are affected by left-wing extremists for rural roads and for Pradhan Mantri Gram Sadak Yojana and a couple of other heads, they take out some money out of that and combine a pool of 5%. They will be funding those 5% for developing national waterways. So the government really wants that. They want to make all the rivers self-sufficient because China and European countries use their navigation systems for transporting materials majorly on sea rather than going on road and railways. So the government also wants to do that. The government wants to make sure and ensure that all the commercialization happens on sea because it's literally very cheap. But as of now, it's very expensive to develop. But speaking to some experts on this, they have pointed out that shipping environment and allocation of about 4,000 crore rupees is just very less for shipping companies. They need more money for that. So now, as of now, it's a good start. It's a positive news that's coming in for the shipping companies. So we'll have to wait and watch. As of now, the status currently stands as that the shipping secretary and the road secretary will be meeting the cabinet secretary very soon. Post that, they will be posting the note to the cabinet. So we can expect in the next 2 months this amendment to be a reality.
Okay, and Chetan, just to make you repeat two of those key points, which is in total, when we look at the kind of boost that the shipping ministry is getting, what is that amount? And also when you look at the allocation for the CRF that we're discussing, what are those two figures that you've mentioned?
Okay, so this year, under the Central Road Fund, the finance ministry has allocated 80,000 crore rupees. So now it's just an approximate amount of what we have heard from our sources. So out of this 80,000 crore rupees, 4,000 crore rupees, that is a 5% of 80,000 crore rupees, that is 4,000 crore rupees will be allocated for Central Road Fund Act amendment and will be given to the maintenance of national waterways. So this is where it all stands right
now. All right, Chetan Bhutani joining us with those details. Thanks a lot. Mayuresh, I'm wondering if we still have you with us. You know, on a cursory level, what our reporter here is really talking about is a real allocation of funding and somewhat of a development that could lead to some kind of a revival in what has been a difficult sector so far. How do you as an investor react to this news?
I think it's wishful thinking on part of the government, and the government has repeatedly stressed upon the point of providing funds for inland waterways and probably connection of rivers and interconnecting all the rivers in the hinterland. But largely, again, I think it's going to be how the execution is expected to pan out. And they are long gestation projects, Fatima. So I think these are not projects which the order wins happen and then the work starts. I think a lot more goes into that. Because of the long gestation nature of the projects, my entire sense is that the kind of returns, both in terms of equity IRRs as well as operating flows, for any of the companies associated with the projects will take time. So I think sentimentally, you might see some amount of stock-specific action happening on a few of the sectors involved for the developments that are happening. But largely, again, I think for the numbers to play out on the balance sheet for these companies will take time.
All right. Also, something that we are going to be closely watching is the kind of outlays that the government has planned. You started out by talking about the post-budget kind of rally that we've seen. The markets have taken it all very well. But what actually goes out to the farming sector by way of irrigation projects, whether you talk about the housing schemes, etc., all of that needs to be kind of looked into closer for the kind of impact that could play out in the markets, Mayuresh. But I'll come to that in just a moment. Before that, I want to go to Hiral because a steady set of numbers are expected from Sun Pharma, within the pharma pack, and this for the December quarter. Profits are expected to rise 21%, likely to come in around 1,700 crore rupees. But Hiral will break it down for us about the expectations. So what's the street estimating this time from Sun Pharma, Hiral?
So overall, a pretty steady set of numbers that are expected. If you talk about where the headline numbers go, the total income is expected to go up to the tune of almost 12% and come in at 7,941 crores. We are expecting the profit to improve by around 21% at 1,717 crores. Margins are also expected to expand and come in at 32.1% versus 30.6%. Now, according to average estimates as well, the growth that we are seeing in terms of our revenues and profitability is concerned is mainly driven by Sun's authorized generic launches of Daiichi Sankyo drugs in the US. Now, the blood pressure drug which I'm talking about is Benicar HCT Azor as well as Tribenzor are the AG launches of Daiichi, and the market size of these drugs is around $2.5 billion. Now, what analysts are saying is that AG sales will offset the price erosion that Sun Pharma will face in terms of where the cancer drug Glivec generic is concerned, as Glivec generic sales are expected to fall by around 30% on a sequential basis on the kind of rising competition as well as, you know, the generic versions of that they have been seeing. Overall, if you see in terms of geographies on the back of it, US is likely to grow in the range of around 10 to 11% on a year-on-year basis, but we might see some bit of a decline that might come in terms of US on a sequential basis. Apart from that, the Indian business again is expected to grow in the range of around 9 to 10%, and this is mainly on the back of a favorable base. And additionally, the slowdown on the back of demonetization will be closely watched in terms of where the management commentary goes. Lastly, if you talk about where rest of the world markets is concerned, that is expected to grow in the range of around 2 to 3%, and emerging markets are expected to grow in the range of almost 20%. Apart from that, if you see in terms of where EBITDA is concerned, we're expecting growth of around 17% at 2,746 crores, and margins, as we mentioned, at 32.1% versus 30.6%. Now, pricing pressure in US may impact margins in this quarter, so that is something that we will be closely watching out for. Apart from that, if you go to see, Glumetza has not yet been launched, so any commentary that the management gives in terms of Glumetza also will be followed. And lastly, commentary in terms of a Halol plant, Mohali plant, as well as US markets are concerned, are key things to watch out for, because any delay in terms of a pending FDA issues as Halol is concerned will act as a major risk for the stock as well.
All right, so that's what we're watching out for when it comes to the numbers from Sun Pharma. Mayuresh, I want to get in your view on this as well, because, you know, typically pharma pack is what you head towards when markets are volatile. It's your ultimate defensive play. But in recent times, we've seen the beaten down nature of the entire pharma pack. How would you rate a stock like Sun Pharma in that kind of space?
No, you're absolutely right in that sense. So again, our own expectations, 10.5% year-on-year growth in terms of top line, close to that 7,800 crore mark. And this would be driven equally by the domestic as well as the export business. On the EBITDA front, our own expectations is EBITDA margin of close to 33.5% against 30.6% that the company had posted on a year-on-year basis. And our own sense about the adjusted profits, we expect the adjusted profits to come in around 1733 crores against 1417 crores. And as Hiral was mentioning, I think, rightfully so, I think the update on the resolutions of the Halol facility is going to be extremely, it is going to be a key point for Sun Pharma. And again, in terms of expectations, expectations of that high specialty business, specifically in the U.S. markets, because they are going to benefit significantly on that count with their ANDA filings that they've got in terms of the pending approvals, as well as expectations of when Plumetza can get launched, because that can be a huge pipeline launch for Sun Pharma over the next few quarters. Again, a cash-rich balance sheet, net cash of almost $850 million. The return on invested capital is exceedingly high, and valuations are not too demanding. So I think if the numbers are as per expectations and the management commentary is on track as the market believes, my own sense is that if the stock corrects any further from the current levels, I think we remain optimistic on the stock going ahead.
Okay, just to shift gears literally, let's talk about the auto major Tata Motors that is expected to post a weaker set of numbers for the December quarter with what is estimated to be 37% of decline in profits this time around. Hiral, of course, is back just to take us through what the street is expecting out of Tamo. Hiral.
So if you see in terms of Tata Motors, again, a dismal set of numbers that is expected in terms of Q3. Overall, in terms of headline numbers, the revenues on a consolidated basis are expected to go down by 7% at 67,264 crores. Overall, if you see in terms of where the profit is concerned, we are expecting a dip to the tune of 37% at 2,209 crores. And margins are seen at 12.6% versus 13% on a year-on-year basis. Now, overall, in terms of JLR volumes, they have increased by around 8.4% on a year-on-year basis, and Jaguar volumes have grown up by around 90%, whilst if you talk about where Land Rover is concerned, volumes have fallen by almost 8.6% during the quarter. In terms of domestic performance, that has remained muted, and this is mainly on the back of the hit that we've seen on the CV segment on the back of demonetization, and domestic volumes have grown by around slowed down to 5.3%. Commercial vehicle volumes have gone down by around 3.3%, and passenger vehicle volumes have been pretty strong across the industry as well as for Tata Motors, where Tata Motors has seen growth levels of almost 27% on a year-on-year basis. Now, strong demand that we've seen in terms of the new Tiago is concerned, that is what has aided the passenger vehicle volume growth in this quarter as well. Apart from that, if you see in terms of our net realizations are concerned, for JLR, we're expecting an increase of 15% on a Y-on-Y basis. Sequentially, that is expected to remain flat, and that is mainly led by the ramp-up that we've seen in terms of our F-Pace is concerned, as well as increasing share if you talk about where China goes. And commodity cost increase could be partially offset by the price hike that Tata Motors has taken. I'm talking about JLR in terms of where November goes. And lastly, leverage as well as forex gain should act as a positive for JLR. And on a standalone basis, we are expecting some bit of a contraction in terms of where margins is concerned to happen. And this is mainly on the back of the CV segment. And lastly, the key things that we will need to watch out for will be the JLR margin adjusted for Forex. That will be a key monitorable. Impact of Brexit in terms of where JLR business is concerned. And lastly, in terms of the update on Chery JV operations as well as the CV business outlook, because that is one segment that has taken a major hit on demonetization. So overall, a weak, maybe a dismal set of numbers, that is what is expected.
All right, Hiral, thanks a lot for taking us through all of that. Mayuresh, this of course is a company that's been very much in focus and in news lately. You know, whether it's a new launch or else the fact that the organization is aiming to be a much leaner organization going into the future, as well as of course the fact that one has been struggling with what is in effect two companies. You have a JLR and Tata Motors, as well as what's happening domestically versus elsewhere. How do you therefore view Tata Motors in terms of investing in it, staying in it, and perhaps certain levels that you think are fair to perhaps exit or just hold on for a while?
Again, going by the volume trend, Fatima, JLR volume is expected to be flattish on a year-on-year basis, around 9% higher on a quarter-on-quarter basis. And yes, I think as Hiral was mentioning, the ramp-up of F-Pace should largely aid realizations for the company as well, specifically in terms of JLR realizations. And JLR does contribute significantly in terms of both the EBITDA and bottom line for the company. Domestically, on their standalone business, again, expecting 8% year-on-year growth in terms of the standalone volumes, realizations expected to come down marginally in terms of what we've seen as a demonetization aftermath. and the margins are still expected to be lower on a year-on-year basis. So yes, I think soft and tepid numbers expected from Tata Motors. And as you're rightly mentioning, I think a lot more has happened in the stock apart from numbers that will come through today. But it still remains one of the cheapest value stock in the auto universe. So it's a question of time as volumes start recovering both on the domestic front, and we've already seen robust volumes happening probably on the JLR front. So there might have been a blip in terms of the wholesale sales that we witnessed in the month gone by. But largely, again, I think if you're holding on to a stock, I think it's better that you hold on over the next few quarters. Because as earnings recovery will start taking place, the earnings and the valuation matrix should improve for Tata Motors.
Right, so going ahead, things look much better for Tata Motors. So it's definitely a hold where Mayuresh Joshi is concerned. Many thanks for joining us with your perspective on the markets, Mayuresh. Glad to have you with us this afternoon. We take a quick breather now. After that, we connect with the management of NDCC. This is the Navratna company, the state-owned company, which